this has been brought to my attention a number of times over the last few months, really. People have inferred, asked, tried to deal with this subject, and usually, you know, today I'd be in Romans chapter 12, and I'd enjoy doing that and studying for that, but this has come up a number of times, and I think a lot of people struggle with this, and so I think it's going to be a good one for all of us to take on board, and that's the subject of forgiveness. Forgiveness. Now, I don't know if you've been hurt by somebody really bad in your life. If you think back, whether you're a child, teenager, adult, whatever. But we've all been hurt by our own families at times, maybe. By your loved ones. The closest ones to you can often hurt you. You can hurt them just by saying things. And so I wonder if you've been hurt over the years, maybe recently, I don't know. So a question I would ask you straight off the bat this morning would be this. Is, have you forgiven them? Is there anyone in your life that you need to forgive? Does anyone need to forgive you? What does the word forgive mean? Well, it means to stop feeling angry or resentful towards someone for an offense or a mistake. We all make them. No longer feel angry or wish to punish them. Synonyms of the word forgiveness: pardon, absolution, exoneration, remission, understanding, tolerance, clemency, mercy, pity, leniency, reprieve, discharge, amnesty, acquittal, clearing, pardoning, vindication. There are some people in life that find it very difficult to forgive a certain person. Maybe you're one of them this morning. And to be honest, to be brutally honest, and I tried to be honest, if somebody took the life of one of my loved ones, I would probably find it very difficult to forgive. Turn to Luke 23, verse 34. For Jesus to say these words while being crucified, absolute agony that he was going through, just shows what pure love he had. Luke 23, verse 34 says this. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them. These are the people that are crucifying him. For they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. As they're gambling for his clothes, as he's in excruciating agony, carrying the sins of the world upon his shoulders, he even says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's incredible. That is pure love. That's a love like you and I have never, ever known. That's God's love. Turn to 1 John, near Revelation. If you're back of your Bible, turn left, come past Jude, then you get into John. You want 1 John 4. 1 John chapter 4, verse 15 and 16. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. You've heard it been said before. How do you describe love? What is love? You know, one word, four letters. What is love? God is love. God's everything, love, like love stems from God. God is love. So when Jesus said those words, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, that's incredible. If I look at my own family, right, bringing it personal to me, the situation I was in, the problems there was behind the scenes that I never saw between my mum and my dad, It was all very sad. It was heartbreaking, to be honest. And I guess that as a family, we could all blame one another. Yet we all had a responsibility. I was to blame. My family, each one of them, was to blame. The whole thing disintegrated. For me, it's too late to sort things out. There's certain things I tried to do and couldn't. But my mum and dad have died now. My sister lives her own life. And all I have is memories. Some good, some not so good. But I need to forgive them for what happened. Or else I'll carry bitterness for the rest of my life. Which is what a lot of people do, and a lot of Christians do this. They carry bitterness. Now, there's a very interesting verse. If you turn to Hebrews, the book of Hebrews, chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. If you're in John, turn left. Hebrews chapter 12, keep going. Verse 15. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any, and here's the key, root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. If you let bitterness get into your heart, it will take root and it will grow. You've got to have it cut out. You've got to get rid of bitterness in your life. All of us have got to do that because it will affect your Christian life. It'll affect you. It will stress you out. You'll think bad things. Bitterness, it takes hold. So when it talks about the root of bitterness, we need to get that out of our lives. Maybe we can't do it ourselves, and we need the Lord to do it for us. And we're going to look and try and understand how we can do that today through this sermon. When I look back again at my own life and reminisce and think about the past, I can feel very sad. And at times, I have to stop myself going to places like that. Can I forgive those who have hurt me? Have I? If not, what can I do? We all need to forgive. And we need to learn to forgive. And we need to keep forgiving. Recently, we've had somebody come on in touch with us, correspond with us because of one of our tracts, and they are struggling to forgive. That's the problem they're going through. They're having problems in forgiving somebody in their lives. Are you? I think there is someone in most families who finds it hard to forgive because they feel that they have been wronged, hurt, upset. It wasn't their fault. They feel. And so they feel the victim. And I guess there is someone in every family, you're no different, I'm no different, we're all the same, who needs to be forgiven. Turn to Psalm 130, verse 4. Psalm 130, verse 4. Five words there says this: there is forgiveness with thee. There is forgiveness with thee. There is always forgiveness with the Lord Jesus Christ. That's just one of the things that makes him so amazing. No matter what we have done to him, he is willing to forgive us. That too breaks my heart. I find that incredible that the Lord Jesus Christ, no matter how I have treated him, not knowing him for the first 18 years of my life, and even the way I've treated him since being saved, a Christian, he still forgives me. I find that mind-blowing. That song is lovely, where it talks about sin, and you're talking to the Saviour, and he turns around to you and says, "What sin? Man alive. What sin?" See, in Hebrews 10, verse 17, it says, "Their sins and iniquities will I remember no more." Your sins and iniquities, God doesn't remember anymore. You do, and I do, and we can remember each other's because perhaps we've hurt one another. Somebody in your family has hurt you, whatever it is. But your sins and iniquities will I remember no more. God forgives. He forgives perfectly. In Acts 13, verse 38, it says this: Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man, that's Jesus Christ, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. It's only Jesus Christ that can forgive your sins, ultimately. If you want to go to heaven, you have to have your sins forgiven, and only Jesus Christ can forgive you. It's not about church. It's not about coming to church. It's not about religion or doing things. It's about the Lord Jesus Christ and him forgiving you of all your sins. Have you asked him? In Acts 5, verse 31, it says this: Him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a saviour, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Turn to Psalm 136. Psalm 136. We're not going to read the whole of this psalm, but you'll notice that there is a reoccurring statement here, the last part. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Look at every verse. For his mercy endureth forever. For his mercy endureth forever. Do you think he's trying to press the point home? All the way through, right the way through to the end. For his mercy endureth forever. Mercy. Mercy. I'm not going to read these verses out, but I'll give you them. I think it's Exodus 34, verse 6 and 7. Psalm 103, verse 8 to 13. Ephesians 2, 4 to 6. 2 Corinthians 1, verse 3. And Titus 3, verse 4 to 7. Mercy. Are you merciful? You know when you get stopped by the police for speeding? Lisa doesn't because she's a driving instructor. But the rest of us have. I've been stopped by the police a few times. Over the years, that is. Not over the last week. And you get pulled over and you feel guilty. You know you've got caught out. You know you've got caught speeding. Whatever it's been, first thing you try and do, you know, you try and justify yourself. I got caught once by a police officer. I was on my motorbike. I was racing to a badminton match. And I'm going up this road and I'm caning it on my motorbike. And then suddenly the blue light, I thought, man alive, he's keeping up well, this guy behind me. Next minute the police light goes on. You get off your bike, they tell you to take the keys out the petrol tank, you know, the ignition, put them on your petrol tank, and then, so you can't drive off. And then he starts giving me the lecture, and I'm begging for mercy. I've got a badminton match. Look, I've got my racket on my back. Look, I'll show you. Look, I've had it really strong. And you're pleading for mercy. You don't want to get done. You don't want the points on your license. And if you're nice and you're friendly and they can see that you're remorseful, you're sorrowful, sometimes they'll let you off. And I'm a salesman, aren't I? I'm an actor. We've got kids to feed. Give them the spiel. I'm joking. And he let me off. And I was very thankful. He was a biker as well, which helps. I wanted mercy. But there are times when you don't get mercy. You break the law. You've all broken the law at some point. God's laws you break all the time. But even man's laws, Romans 13, ordination of the laws, the governments, they set rules down and you break the laws. So when you go to the courthouse, and some of you all know this because we've gone through this before, but when you go to the courthouse, there are six statues outside the courthouse. Picture the scene. You've been caught, whether it's speeding, whatever it is, you've been caught and now you're going to court. There are six statues outside the courthouse. The first statue is Wisdom, with her head bowed. The next statue, before you go in, you're just looking at these statues before you go passing, they're going to pass sentence on you. There is justice, which is blind. Then there is authority with big muscles. Then there is liberty, handling a harp while saluting peace. Then there is peace with a harp in hand. And then the sixth statue is prosperity, having waters and fruits coming from her veins. Six statues outside the courthouse: wisdom, justice, authority, liberty, peace, and prosperity. There is one statue missing, the seventh statue. What is it? Mercy. There's no mercy in the courthouse. You're going to court and judgment is going to be passed. There is no mercy. But with God, there is mercy. His mercy endureth forever. Are you merciful? Can you forgive? What we're going to go through today, and I'm going to give you three factual accounts of forgiveness. Everyone in this room should be able to forgive, because none of you have gone through what these people have gone through. Let alone they have never gone through what the Lord has gone through. Mercy. Are you merciful? Have you asked the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive you? I did that on May the 4th, 1989, at the age of 18. I asked Jesus Christ to forgive me of all my sins. Think of all the times that you have hurt the Lord by what you have thought, by what you have said, and what you have done. He has his laws, and you break his laws. He wants the best for you, and you don't want it. You want to go your own way, rebel against the Lord. Oftentimes, we don't even know when we have hurt someone. Think how much more that goes on regarding the Lord. The way you used to live. I have Christians all the time, and you know, I'm as guilty as anybody, that they feel like you've wasted so much time in your life. For 18 years, I wasn't a Christian. The first 18 years, I thank God I got saved at 18. But for 18 years, I lived life the way I wanted to live life. I hurt the Lord all the time. I'm his creation. But I turned my back on him. I didn't want to know anything about him. So for 18 years, I went my own way and did my own thing. That hurt the Lord. But what about when you become a Christian? So I've been saved for 34 years. Have I hurt the Lord in those 34 years? Countless times. Putting my will above his. Doing my own thing. Turning my back on him. Many Christians just use the Lord like a shopping list. When you want something, you'll go out and you'll talk to him. When things go wrong in your life, you're down on your knees. You're serious with God when things go bad. But when things are going good, you don't talk to him much. You only use him when you need him. A lot of Christians are like that. Do you like getting used? Are you hurting the Lord by the way you are living now? By your lack of commitment? You can't be bothered to come to church. You don't try to reach lost souls with the gospel. It's not important to you. How you treat others and cast aside those whom you dislike or even hate. God says if you hate someone, you have committed murder in your heart. That's what God says. The Lord Jesus Christ said that. The way you treat your friends, your family. Are you hurting the Lord because of the way you treat others? All this hurts the Lord Jesus Christ. He wants you to forgive. He wants you to make amends, if possible. Let them know that you love them. He wants you to do that. You're going to learn how to do that by the end of this, if you're not doing it already. How else are you hurting the Lord? By your sin? The sin in your life? By your lack of care, love, mercy? You seldom think of others. You're so self-conceited, so self-centered. You hurt the Lord, you grieve the Spirit of God. Ephesians 4:30. You quenched the Spirit, 1 Thessalonians 5:19, by your selfishness, your self-righteousness. You hurt the Lord by your lack of interest in his word. You don't pick it up from day to day. Once a Sunday, you get into the Bible a little bit, and that's it for the rest of the week. These are just a few things of how you grieve and quench and stifle the Spirit of God and hurt the Lord. What about giving your best? Do you always give your best? We're not all talented, you know, we're talented in different ways. We're not all talented at the same thing, but you give your best. You try your hardest, do you? What about with your own family? Are you trying your hardest with them? What about with your friends? What about with the people in the church? Are you trying your hardest with them? Or you discard, push certain people away, you have your favourites? How are you hurting the Lord today? And do you even think about the hurt that you caused the Lord? Some Christians are so self-centred, they're oblivious to the problems they are causing. And they need something to shake them to the core, to wake them up. And this, folks, can be very painful. Oftentimes it happens when Christians don't care. It's interesting, Paul was saying with evangelism, and he's absolutely spot on. You know, he goes out there, you have the confrontation, you have people coming up to you, and you get the abuse, you get the hassle. They can be aggressive and angry, and you can hit them for six with biblical knowledge. You've got the knowledge that you can hit them for six, but if you've got no love, if you don't care, then what are they going away? It's not winning an argument. It's not about winning an argument. And a lot of Christians don't get that. You think you're superior to somebody else because you've got bigger and better Bible knowledge. You know more about the Bible than somebody else. What does that mean? They will know that you're my disciples, the Lord said, by your love one for another. Do you love? Do you have mercy? Do you forgive? Do you even think how you hurt those around you by what you say, your actions, and the way you come across? Does this even cross your mind? Some people in this church, have been hurt by things said by another when that person never even realized what they were actually saying. They weren't thinking. People leave the church by something that's been said. Leaving a church? Do you leave your job because of something that's been said? But people leave church so easily. There's a great verse, and we all need to turn to this one. Psalm 141, verse 3. They say, don't open your mouth and put your foot in it, you know, or put both feet in it. The Bible says, set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth. Keep the door of my lips. You see, we can be so irrational. We can say things we don't mean. And we've all done it. And we've all hurt someone by what we've said. Because we're not thinking. Automatically, you react. Have you hurt someone in this church by what you have said? By your actions? Start thinking about the way you come across. Your character. Your character, I ask you to describe yourself in one word this morning. Your character, what you say. If you've got problems with family members, you ought to try to put it right. Time's running out. I wish I'd have done more with my own family. This is another thing. You make the first move. Do it, not for them or for even you, but do it for the Lord. For the Lord Jesus. Because you love him, you make the first move. You're doing it for the Lord. You need to get rid of your pride. Don't end up like I've done, and now it's too late to make amends. And I know it's hard. I get that. I know it's hard. But it's not a life and death situation. It's predominantly a pride issue, to be honest. Make the first move. The more you love the Lord Jesus Christ, the easier it will be for you to forgive others. That's the key. That's the key to forgiveness. Turn to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. The scripture says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, that's how you get redeemed, through the blood of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Every sin you've ever committed, think about this, is washed away by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the only thing that can wash away your sins. If you are trusting in his blood atonement, if you're trusting in the gospel, the death, the burial, and the resurrection. That's the gospel. And think of that. You won't have to be judged for your sins. That's amazing. That is absolutely mind-blowing. I've had 53 years of a sinful life on this earth, and I'm not going to have my sins brought up because I am under the blood of Jesus Christ. I've asked the Lord to forgive me. I am a Christian. He took my place, he became my substitute, he died in my place as a sinner, even though there was no sin in him. He was judged for my sins and for your sins. He went to hell on my behalf and your behalf. Acts 2, 27 to 32 and Psalm 16, verse 10. So if I was to ask you this, are you, everybody around here in this church this morning, are you trusting in the finished work of Jesus Christ? Yes or no? If not, you are carrying every single sin you've ever committed with you. You see, you either give your sins to the Lord Jesus Christ, who died in your place and rose again, and you put your faith and trust in him that he died for you, shed his blood so you could have your sins washed away, rose again, and you're trusting in that blood atonement to wash away your sins, and then you can go to heaven, or you can say, I'm going to do it my way, I'm going to be religious, I'm going to be an atheist, I'm going to do it my way, whatever it is, and I'm going to work my way to heaven, I don't believe in any of this, and you will carry every single one of your sins from the moment you're born to whatever date this is, to whatever date you die, you will carry every one of your sins to hell. You don't have to. You have a choice. Everybody in this room has a choice. Have you asked the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive your sins? If not, you need to do it now. Right now where you're sitting, ask the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive you of all your sins and save you. Turn to Genesis 50. First book of the Bible, Genesis, verse 50. Look at this. Keep your finger there and go to Genesis 37. We could spend months and months, maybe years, in Genesis 37. Because Joseph is a perfect type of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amazing type. The best type in all of Scripture is Joseph. And Genesis 37 is mind-blowing. The comparison between Joseph and Jesus Christ. And Genesis 50, talking about Joseph again, look at this. Verse 15. And when Joseph's brethren saw that their father was dead, they said, Joseph will peradventure hate us and will certainly requite us all the evil which we did unto him. And they sent a messenger unto Joseph, saying, thy father did command before he died, saying, so shall ye say unto Joseph, forgive, I pray thee now, the trespass of thy brethren and their sin. For they did unto thee evil, and now we pray thee, forgive the trespass of the servants of the God of thy father. And Joseph wept when they spake unto him. They wanted mercy, and they wanted forgiveness for the way they have treated him. And his brethren also went and fell down before his face, and they said, Behold, we be thy servants. And Joseph said unto them, Fear not, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive. It's very interesting, we're going to keep reading in a second, very interesting in your life, when bad things happen, and we automatically think it's not of God or whatever, and we blame people, and we think all the wrong things, we jump to conclusions, we're very irrational, and then suddenly, when you've come through this thing, something better has come, and you're in a better position than you've ever been in, and the Lord did it for your good. You're learning a lesson. Even though somebody meant to hurt you, you've come through it, and you've learned a lesson through it, and the Lord has taught you something. That's life. Life is a learning curve. Verse 21. Now therefore, fear ye not, I will nourish you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spake kindly unto them. Mercy and forgiveness. And Joseph dwelt in Egypt, he and his father's house. And Joseph lived 110 years. And Joseph saw Ephraim's children of the third generation. The children also of Machir, and the son of Manasseh were brought up upon Joseph's knees. And Joseph said unto his brethren, I die, and God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land and unto the land which he sware to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And Joseph took an oath of the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you. And look at this for a verse. And ye shall carry up my bones from hence. His bones weren't left in Egypt. Egypt is a type of the world. Joseph is a type of Christ. They couldn't find Jesus Christ's bones. There's a cross-reference on that. Luke 24, verse 7. That's amazing. So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. I find it absolutely amazing to read some of the stories about forgiveness. And there are thousands of them. And I'm going to read three stories, very brief stories to you about forgiveness. And you need to learn, and I need to learn, how to forgive better. Listen to this. In October 2006, after a long shift at the fire department, 20-year-old Matt Swatzell fell asleep while driving and crashed into another vehicle. He awoke to the most awful sound he had ever heard, realizing he had crashed into June Fitzgerald, who was pregnant with her 19-month-old daughter, Faith, by her side. Faith survived the crash, but June and her unborn child did not. According to Today, Fitzgerald's husband, a full-time pastor, asked for the man's diminished sentence, saying, You forgive as you've been forgiven. He meets with Swatzell regularly, and their friendship continues to this day. You talk about forgiveness. That's incredible. Many of you, if not all of you, have heard of Corrie Ten Boom. You've read her book, The Hiding Place. You've seen the documentary, maybe, the film. Corrie Ten Boom, the author of The Hiding Place, recalls forgiving a guard at the concentration camp where her sister Betsy died. It was in a church in Munich that I saw him, a balding, heavy-set man in a grey overcoat, a brown felt hat clutched between his hands. People were filing out of the basement room where I had just spoken, moving along the rows of the wooden chairs to the door at the rear. It was 1947, and I'd come from Holland to a defeated Germany with the message that God forgives. It was the truth they needed most to hear in that bitter, bombed-out land, and I gave them my favourite mental picture, maybe because the sea is never far from a Hollander's mind. I like to think that that's where our sins are forgiven and are thrown. When we confess our sins, I said, God cast them into the deepest ocean, gone forever, she said to the congregation. The solemn faces stared back at me, not quite daring to believe. There were never questions after a talk in Germany in 1947. People stood up in silence. In silence, they collected their wraps. In silence, they left the room. And that's when I saw him. Working his way forward against the others, one moment I saw the overcoat and the brown hat. The next, I saw a blue uniform and a visored cap with skull and crossbones. It came back with a rush. The huge room with its harsh overhead lights, the pathetic pile of dresses and shoes in the centre of the floor, the shame of walking naked past this man. I could see my sister's frail form ahead of me, ribs sharp beneath the parchment skin. Betsy, how thin you were. Betsy and I had been arrested for concealing Jews in our home during Nazi occupation of Holland. This man had been a guard at Ravensbrück concentration camp, where we were sent. Now he was in front of me, his hand thrust out, saying, a fine message, how good it is to know that, as you say, all our sins are at the bottom of the sea. And I, who had spoken so glibly of forgiveness, fumbled in my pocketbook rather than take his hand. He would not remember me. Of course, how could he remember one prisoner among those thousands of women? But I remembered him and the leather crop swinging from his belt. It was the first time since my release that I'd been face to face with one of my captors, and my blood seemed to freeze. You mentioned Ravensbrück in your talk, he was saying. I was a guard there. No, he did not remember me. But since that time, he went on, I have become a Christian. I know that God has forgiven me for the cruel things that I did there, but I would like to hear it from your lips as well. Again, the hand came out. Will you forgive me? And I just stood there. Betsy had died in that place. Could he erase her slow, terrible death simply for the asking? It could not have been many seconds that he stood there, hand held out, but to me it seemed like hours, as I wrestled with the most difficult thing I ever had to do. For I had to do it, I knew that. The message that God forgives as a prior condition, that we forgive those who have injured us. If you do not forgive men their trespasses, Jesus says, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses. I knew it not only as a commandment of God, but as a daily experience. Since the end of the war, I had had a home in Holland for victims of Nazi brutality. Those who were able to forgive their former enemies were able also to return to the outside world and rebuild their lives, no matter what the physical scars. Those who nursed their bitterness, note that, those who nursed their bitterness remained invalids. It was as simple and horrible as that. And still I stood there with the coldness clutching my heart, but forgiveness is not an emotion. I knew that too. Forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. Jesus, help me, I prayed silently. I can lift my hand. I can do that much. You supply the feeling. And so woodenly, mechanically, I thrust my hand into the one stretched out in front of me. And as I did, an incredible thing took place. The current started in my shoulder, raced down my arm, sprang into our joined hands, and then the healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being, bringing tears to my eyes. "I forgive you, brother," I cried, "with all my heart." That's Corrie ten Boom. I'm not even in the same class as that lady. I'll give you one more story, just a brief one. Some of you know this guy, Louis Zamperini. He was held in a Japanese concentration camp. 4 days before his 81st birthday in January 1998, Zamperini ran a leg in the Olympic torch relay for the Winter Olympics in Nagano, Japan, not far from the prisoner of war camp where he had been held. While there, he attempted to meet with his chief and most brutal tormentor during the war, Mutsuhiro Watanabe, also known as the Bird, who had evaded prosecution as a war criminal. Watanabe, however, refused to meet him. Nevertheless, Zamperini sent him a letter stating that while he suffered great mistreatment from him, he had forgiven him. It is unknown whether Watanabe even read the letter. Zamperini never received any response. Watanabe died in 2003. He was beaten to a pulp in that prisoner of war camp by that guy they called the Bird. Yet afterwards he became a Christian and he toured with Billy Graham and gave his testimony all over the world. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Who haven't you forgiven and why? Have you had to go through anything like these three people I've just read to you, these accounts, factual accounts? Two in a prisoner of war camp, a concentration camp, and one of somebody that took somebody else's wife and child. Yet those two guys have become friends because the husband forgave him. You all need to go home and forgive those you need to. Perhaps you need to write to them if you need to. Pour out your heart to them and explain to them why you feel you need to forgive them. But you need to do it as soon as possible. Before it's too late, learn to forgive. Drawing to a close. In 1 Kings 8, verse 50, it says this: "And forgive thy people that have sinned against thee, and all their transgressions wherein they have transgressed against thee. And give them compassion before them who carried them captive, that they may have compassion on them." We need love, we need mercy, we need forgiveness, and we need compassion. If you have your Bibles, turn to Psalm 25. Psalm 25, verse 18. "Look upon mine affliction and my pain, and forgive all my sins." Have you asked the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive you? What's stopping you? I was 18 on May the 4th, 1989, and I did it. And he changed my life. In Psalm 86, verse 5, it says, "For thou, Lord, art good and ready to forgive, and plenteous in mercy unto all them that call upon thee." Matt was urging his grandparents who were dying to call upon the Lord and ask for mercy and forgiveness for their sins. They may be days, hours, weeks, who knows, left. They've got an opportunity of getting saved and having all their sins forgiven. You can get saved right now where you are sitting if you ask the Lord Jesus to forgive you. "For thou, Lord, art good and ready to forgive, and plenteous in mercy unto all them that call upon thee." If you don't ask, if you don't call upon him, he cannot forgive you. That's the unpardonable sin. You've got to receive the gift offered, and that gift is Jesus Christ, 2 Corinthians 9:15. Have you received him as your Saviour, or have you rejected him? Turn to Luke 17, verse 3. We're nearly through. Luke 17, verse 3. Take heed to yourselves. If thy brother trespass against thee, rebuke him, and if he repent, forgive him. And if he trespass against thee seven times in a day, and seven times in a day turn again to thee, saying, I repent, thou shalt forgive him. So what's it with you? You can't forgive just once. Learn to forgive. Ask the Lord to help you to forgive. In 1 John 1 verse 9 it says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We can have all of our sins forgiven. Think about that. All of our sins washed away in the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can stand clean today by asking the Lord to forgive you, as I did all those years ago. It's a choice. You have a choice. We're not Calvinists. You have a choice. It's your choice. Receive the Lord Jesus or go out those doors and reject him yet again. It's your choice. There is a difference, a huge difference, between standing and state, between justification and sanctification, between being redeemed and being religious, trying to work your way to heaven, between doing and done. Jesus Christ has done it all. He's the unspeakable gift that you are to receive. The Lord knows how to forgive. Do you? The Lord is long-suffering and of great mercy, forgiving iniquity and transgression. Numbers 14, verse 18. What a verse that is. I want to read to you two passages before we finish. Turn to Ephesians 4. Paul teaches us how to forgive. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29 to 32. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamour and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. That's the key to forgiveness. Even as Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Colossians 3, turn there. Colossians chapter 3. I know it's hard. Colossians 3, verse 12 to 17. Buried with him in baptism. Sorry, Colossians 3, verse 12. Put on therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, that's another key, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. That's the key. And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called, in one body, and be ye thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. In Psalm 32, verse 1, we read, "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered." In Psalm 85, verse 2 and 3, "Thou hast forgiven the iniquity of thy people, thou hast covered all their sin, thou hast taken away all thy wrath, thou hast turned thyself from the fierceness of thine anger." And the last passage I want to read to you before we close is in Luke 7. Luke 7. Verse 36 to 50. "And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment and stood at his feet behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee, which had bidden him, saw it, he spake within himself, saying, This man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner," probably a prostitute. "And Jesus answering, said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he saith, Master, say on. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence, and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me therefore, which of them will love him most? Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And he said unto him, Thou hast rightly judged. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, Seest thou this woman? I entered into thine house. Thou gavest me no water for my feet, but she hath washed my feet with tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much, but to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. And he said unto her, Thy sins are forgiven. And they that sat at meat with him began to say within themselves, Who is this that forgiveth sins also? And he said to the woman, Thy faith hath saved thee. Go in peace. Her sins, which were many, she loved much because she had been forgiven much. In order for you to forgive more and better and deeper, you need to love more. You need to love the Lord Jesus Christ more. Imagine how God forgave after seeing his son beaten, tortured, mocked, ridiculed, spat upon, stripped naked, then nailed to a cross. All because of our sins, your sins and my sins, put Christ on the cross. And the father has to watch his son die. And then Jesus says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. How the Lord forgives us after what we put the Lord Jesus Christ through. The more you realize that it was your sins that put Jesus Christ on the cross, the more you'll be able to forgive everyone around you who has wronged you. Learn to forgive. And if you're struggling, learn to love the Lord Jesus Christ more. The more you love, the more you'll forgive. Don't carry grudges. Don't carry bitterness. Let it go. Take it all to the Lord and ask him to help you. There will be times when forgiveness won't be easy. I get that. And it's in those times, those tough times, you need to swallow your pride. You need to pour out your heart to the Lord and ask him to help you to forgive that person. If you don't forgive, it will be detrimental to your Christian walk and your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Jesus knows how to forgive. Do you? Let's pray.
So long ago, I cried out for mercy back then. I bled the blood of Jesus, begged him to forgive my sin. But I still can't forget it, it just won't go away. So I wept again, Lord, wash my sin. But this is all he said.
Forgetfulness.